Now, we here in Austin are very proud of our green belts and our hike and bike trails, but if you're a gardener and you walk down one of those trails, one thing you notice, lots of invasive species. So we're going to be talking about what we as gardeners can do about that. I'm joined by Erin Cord from the City of Austin Watershed Protection Department. It's great to have you with us.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and let's start off by talking about what is an invasive.
Yes, an invasive species is, so when we say invasive, we want to say non-native invasive because they're not from around here.
Right.
Usually from the other side of the world, actually, and they've been brought over for a variety of reasons, but they tend to overtake and outcompete our native species. And in this case, we're talking about plants. So just taking over a plant community, sometimes forming almost a monoculture.
Yeah, well, you know, I live adjacent to a hike and bike trail, and I've noticed that over time.
Yeah.
Japanese ligustrum, privet, chinaberry. Nothing against any plants from China, except they don't really belong here. They don't play friendly with the native plants.
Exactly. There's nothing really checking them here because they don't have their natural predators. So they really kind of just take over. They do very well.
So why is watershed protection involved with this particular issue? A lot of people think, God, it's a green plant. It's got to be good, right?
Yeah, it's complicated. I mean, we're really looking at the invasives that are dominating our riparian areas, and that's kind of that transition between the actual creek and the upland.
Sure.
So what you want is to have a diverse riparian area with a lot of different plant species. And if you have that and it's thriving, it's really important for creek health.
Yeah.
But if it's dominated by one thing or a few things like ligustrum or nandina, you're going to have some issues. So that area is not going to be as effective at filtering and capturing the water from stormwater runoff, which is really important for water quality. It's not going to be quality habitat for wildlife. You know, we have a lot of creeks that are right up against green belts and a lot of our urban wildlife. It's really important habitat for them.
Right.
And then also, if ligustrum is there and it's growing really fast, it outcompetes all of our native tree seedlings that are trying to grow up because it just creates all this shade.
Yeah.
And then recreationally, you know, if you're hiking on the hike a bike trail and you see a wall of ligustrum, it's not very inviting.
No. In fact, there are some places on some of the hike and bike trails that are downright spooky.
Yeah, exactly.
And, you know,
it is.
It's like, oh, I'm not so sure I want to go down there.
Yeah.
When a native mix would have understory plants.
Yes.
As well as the shrubs and trees.
Yes, we'd have those vertical layers.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's a real benefit to the environment in terms of the water as well, right?
Yes, absolutely. You know, you want a lot of different plant species there to filter that water, as I said, and just make it cleaner for water quality and to shade the creek, you know, to keep the sun out. And so there's a lot of different benefits that having a diverse plant community can give you.
You know, we don't think about it that much, but we have what we call, like to call, ephemeral creeks. Sometimes they flow, sometimes they don't.
Yes, we have a lot of those in Austin.
Right. I think predominant in Texas, actually.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
But, you know, if you have this mix, it keeps the water in the creeks longer, right?
Yes, absolutely, yes. It keeps it from drying up, which provides kind of these pockets of refuge for a lot of creek species and, you know, keeps that water clean.
Yeah, well, privet or ligustrum, kind of ME one or two on the list for sure.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the related species, privet and ligustrum, but they're equally bad. What are some of the other ones that you commonly see?
We see a lot of nandina or heavenly bamboo, which is a really popular landscape plant still, unfortunately. We see a lot of vines. You know, Japanese honeysuckle is really common.
Yeah.
We have certain places where cat's claw vine is really prevalent.
I hate that. Okay, we'll just move on.
Yeah, it's aggressive.
Yes, tad bit. Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, talk about what the gardening community can do as a result of these kinds of things.
Yeah, I mean, we really just want to educate people about what's native, what's not, what's invasive, what's not, so they can really make mindful choices about what they bring into their yard.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of great native species you can get instead of these non-native invasives that are just wonderful. And then also we just want people to look in their yard, see what they already have. You know, if you move to a new house in Austin, you probably have a ligustrum in your backyard.
Or a nandina,
yeah. So, you know, we want them to kind of make a long-term plan to take those out and put something native in.
Right. Well, you know, there's some things you can do in terms of remediation, for example, like the nandina. It's like I have dug out, and I'm guilty of planting some of this 40 years ago. However, digging it out is a huge task.
Yes, it is. It's hard.
So what I've taken to do is aggressively prune off the berries.
Yes.
While they're green.
That's great. That's one way, you know, if you're really in love with your Nandina and you don't want to get rid of it, we
Not so much in love
with it. We say cut those berries off because then the birds won't eat them and it won't spread.
Yeah.
I have a staff member who swears by cutting it down and then putting a bucket over it and just kind of letting that bucket sit there for a long time and it eventually kills the plant. But you may
a
not want that.
Unattractive in the garden.
Not for everybody.
But you know, I've actually talked to somebody this week about that technique.
Oh, so, interesting. All right.
So, you know, some people think about the plants we've talked about and say, I like my ligustrum. It provides a beautiful screen that protects me from my neighbor's view. I don't want to do without it.
Yeah.
What are some good alternatives for that? Because that's a common complaint.
Yeah. I mean, I think for ligustrum, a great native alternative is cherry laurel, which has a really similar structure. So it kind of provides that screen as well.
And
the leaves, it's evergreen, which is nice. And, you know, once you get these natives established, they are really low maintenance usually.
That's the thing I love about the native plants.
Me too, yeah.
And I talk about this often, but I have a garden that is large. The fundamental plants, the basic plants, are native for the most part. And even in the driest times, a light watering once a week by hand is all I do.
Yeah, it doesn't take much, which is great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So real benefit there for the water as well.
Yes, absolutely.
Lest we
conserve that water.
Right. So let's talk about some other kinds of plants that be alternative. Let's talk about the Nandina. People like those bright red berries.
I totally understand that. A good alternative is the Yaupon holly because you'll get those red berries still.
Right. Yeah.
And it has a lot of wildlife value.
Yeah.
You know, also the Possumhaw, which
love Possumhaw.
Our deciduous holly also has those berries. So you can still have that visual interest. You just have a native species instead.
Yeah. And then there are a lot of other kinds of cool things that grow along our streams that we can incorporate into our gardens maybe, you know, like creek plum or, rough leaf dogwood.
Oh, I love rough leaf dogwood.
Those plants we could garden with, they produce berries and the birds can spread those instead.
That would be great.
I wanted to talk about you mentioned get clawvine. I said its name out loud, sort of. What's a good alternative for some of those invasive vines?
So they're hard to get rid of, but if you can, we recommend crossvine, beautiful native vine. You know,
very aggressive, but it's
good. But good aggressive, I guess.
And beautiful.
Yeah, so beautiful. Hummingbirds love it. A lot of pollinators like it too. Mm-hmm. Or coral honeysuckles, one of our native honeysuckles.
And that's a well-behaved vine.
It is. That is a well-behaved vine, So, you know, if you're looking for something that's a little more well-behaved, coral honeysuckle's great.
And, you know, I often wish I could I take walks around the Greenbelt with my loppers. I try not to do that because I think a lot of people would take an objection to me lopping plants on a Greenbelt. But one that I really hate is Chinaberry. They're just like so invasive.
Yeah.
And you see them everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
What's a good alternative for that? People like it for a variety of reasons. The little flowers, they're kind of attractive, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's a flowering tree.
Yeah.
I always like to recommend oak trees because, you know, they are a little slower growing, but they are really beautiful. We have some beautiful native red oaks. You get that fall color.
Right.
Also, you know, cedar elm is a great replacement for Chinaberry because it has a really similar structure, but it's a great native tree.
It's a tough plant, too.
It is so tough. I mean, it's one of my favorites. I think it's kind of growing in popularity, but, you know, it's a great tree.
Yeah. I think it's underutilized as a new plant for sure,
Absolutely.
But it is a dominant plant in Austin.
Yeah, you'll see it everywhere. It's one of the few things that's really still doing fairly well.
Yeah, and it's a great street tree or backyard tree.
Yeah.
So, and very, very, very hardy. And the small leaf, the little leaf privet, which is another one which I really despise, but what's a good alternative for that?
I think for that, Yaupon would be great as well, or elbow bush actually is something that I actually have in my yard that I love because it's one of the first things that blooms in the spring, so you'll get kind of those early pollinators to it.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of grows in a similar structure, so it's like a low-growing bush.
Yeah, so does Yaupon. It has
the
same kind of shape to it.
So, yeah.
Well, that's great. So gardeners can make a difference.
Absolutely, yes.
And so give Mother Nature a hand by using the right plants to begin with, and then let the birds spread those around.
Yes, the birds will do that.
Okay, well, very good. Well, Erin, it's been a real pleasure meeting you. Thank you so much for coming on board, and keep up the vigilant protection of our greenbelts.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, great to have you with us, Erin. And coming up next, it's Stephanie.